It was the first real sound that had ever been transmitted to a human ear by electricity.
Hi everyone and welcome to episode 7 of the Music Dissectors, recorded August 19th, 2017. I'm your host David Holloway and with me as always is Matthew J.C. Powell, major U2 fan and all-round good guy. How are you, Matthew?
Why do you do that to me? I'll cop to major good guy or all-round good guy. U2... Tolerator?
U2 Tolerator. That's a good job title. I like that. Someone needs to keep them honest.
I have my sister is an enormous fan of U2. So I have learned to
tolerate's probably the best word.
Keep my counsel.
Yeah. We'll say. Yeah, it's not worth causing sibling issues over a band.
Pretty much, yeah. They're not my absolute number one favorite. Let's put it that way.
No, but as we alluded to, and I was worried after I did allude to last episode that the next album would be U2. I thought it'd be just my luck, and we won't be able to secure our guest, but we did. So, I mean, our guest this week is Ken Lee, a musician and photographer. And I will link to the YouTube video in the show notes. So Ken himself, I believe, finds that very amusing, that video. So
you'd have to.
It's a funny video. It was American Idol, wasn't it? Anyway, I'll link to it in the show notes.
Something like Bulgaria's Got Talent or something.
Yeah, something like that. So yeah, Ken's based out of Los Angeles and has come to us to talk about U2's Unforgettable Fire, and we cover a lot of ground. And I think
actually, let's be honest with ourselves. Okay, I do slag off U2 because they got it coming, but overall, it's not actually a bad album.
No.
Not actually a bad album. As long as you don't think of it too much as a U2 album. But we'll get into that.
We will. So yeah, have a listen and let's hear more about this non-U2 U2 album. Hi, Ken. Thanks for joining us across time zones.
Absolutely. Glad to be here.
Because what part of the U.S. do you live in, Ken?
I'm in Los Angeles. So right now it's probably not quite 40 degrees, but approaching there. Maybe.
Celsius?
That's Celsius. I've translated for you.
Yeah, you're a good man. So Ken and I have known each other. It's a bit like Matthew, you and I. We've known each other for a number of years, but have never met face to face. Although Ken and I have more of an excuse not to meet face to face than you and I do. But so we've been involved as musicians on those good old fashioned forums since early 2000s, probably, wouldn't it be, Ken?
Early 2000s, because I joined Music Player 2001, I believe.
Yeah, so we both frequented a keyboard forum over those years, and so Ken was an obvious person to ask to come on the podcast because he's one hell of a musician, but he's also got a great artistic temperament, and I think it's fair to say, Ken, probably your equal or probably bigger passion is photography. Is that fair to say?
I think so. At this point, it occupies even more of my time than music, although not by much. it's relatively new, too, because I've been doing music pretty much my entire life and recording music my entire adult life. But the photography, I didn't start getting into it until I discovered night photography. And I just was really immediately passionate about that in a way that I'm only passionate about, just a few other things like traveling or music. So,
great. And I think that it's fair to say there's a U2 link to your photography, in that there's one place that you're frequented at least twice, if not more, that relates to U2. Do you want to explain a little bit about one of your favorite locations?
Oh, gosh. I don't. What would that be?
The Joshua Tree.
There's a forum. To be honest, I don't believe I've ever been on there.
No, the Joshua Tree location. I thought you'd been. This is going well.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Sorry. Okay. So, yes, you're absolutely right. There is a national park near me called Joshua Tree National Park, and there's quite a relationship between that and U2, because U2 stayed. Well, technically, they stayed outside of the park in the town of Joshua Tree, but they stayed in a place called the Harmony Motel, which is a charming motel, and went inside the park. But curiously, though, the interesting thing is that the tree that is featured on the cover of the Joshua Tree album is actually not in Joshua Tree National Park.
Oh, okay.
It's in the Mojave Desert. And then everybody thinks it's in Joshua Tree National Park, but it's actually in the Mojave Preserve. And I've never actually been there, but apparently the original tree that the band posed by died about 10 or 15 years ago. It just died and collapsed. But they've apparently left a plaque nearby the tree, and I've yet to visit this.
Well, it's got to be a bucket list thing, Ken, I'd say. And
a plaque for a tree. Wow.
Right.
and just to our listeners, I think just the last exchange proves that we don't pre-brief our guests about what we're going to talk about. So that's good. And obviously we're not talking about the Joshua Tree either, Ken, as we're going to talk about the album before that you've chosen, The Unforgettable Fire. So you were pretty, when we talked initially about coming on the podcast, it didn't seem to take you a lot of time to come up with that choice. So is it fair to say it's a pretty pivotal album for you?
It is in numerous ways, because first of all, it's my favorite U2 album, just pure and simple. It's my favorite. When it came out, it made a huge impression on me. It had this beautiful atmosphere and gauze that I just really related to. And it sort of bridged the gap between some of the experimental music that I was doing and rock and pop music. It fused them together in a way that I thought was just glorious. And so it made an enormous impression on me, and particularly with the overall sound and also the Edge's guitar playing and his overall tone, which I just love. Huge influence.
And it's fascinating you mentioned the word gauze. So when I did the research
That stuck out for me as well.
Yeah. Gauze. And it's in doing the research for this, there's numerous quotes attributed to the band, but particularly to Bono, saying that he sees this album as a bit like an oil painting. It's a bit smudged in parts. It's a bit indistinct. And some of the songs, most interestingly, Pride and Bad, he sees as still incomplete sketches. So it's fascinating you sort of picked up on that. It's a little bit indistinct. Is that fair to say?
I really completely agree with that. And I would actually say that a number of the songs on here appear like sketches. I mean, the least of which is obviously the Elvis Presley in America one. That seems almost like a demo, a really rough demo in its sound. It's this sort of, if I remember correctly, it's a sort of a slowed down backing track from a sort of homecoming.
Till the
very much considered an experiment at the time as well.
Yeah, and then there was an instrumental, I think it's called the 4th of July,
yep.
Right? Mm-hmm. That one, too, was basically an improvisation where Adam Clayton was playing that really simple bass melody, and The Edge joined in with him, and unbeknownst to either of them, Eno was recording them. And that basically, he added some treatments, and that was the finished song.
And it's interesting you mention that too, as far as Eno recording and the recording process. So Ken, I don't know whether you've seen the sort of 30-minute documentary they released on the making of Unforgettable Fire at the time, or it was a few months after. I think it was 1985 it was released, and it has heaps of footage of Eno and Lanois recording the guys at Slain Castle initially, and then when they went to Windmill Lane Studios. And what stood out for me is the process was so much driven by the music, with Bono slotting in the lyrics afterwards. It reminded me a lot of the interview we did with Al Wright about In Excess, Listen Like Thieves, which was similar as far as the guys were recording the music and then running in latest mixes for Michael Hutchence to fit lyrics around. Have you seen that doco?
Yes, I saw it back in the day, so I haven't seen it in, 32 years or something like this. But I did see it at the time, yes.
And it's even I, Matthew, struggle with watching it because the guys are just so intense and earnest and you know, talking so deeply. It's a bit like a prelude to Rattle and Hum, as the movie, as far as how intense they are about everything. But it is a fascinating insight into the process.
Right. They do take themselves very, very seriously.
But there's some humorous moments in it, though, where I distinctly remember this one scene in the documentary where they're showing Bono and he's just emoting. He's singing. I don't remember what it was or whether it even appears on the album, but he's just emoting. And then the song ends and Lanois and Eno are just sort of looking at him, and then one of them says something to the effect of, that's pretty good, Bono. Maybe you could stand up for this one.
Yes, that's right. No, that is absolutely in there. And he gives it his all. And they've been absolutely sarcastic, saying, yeah, you could give it a bit more oomph, this next take, please. It was funny as... So, I mean, 1984, as you said, 32, 33 years ago. So, Ken, do you remember when it came out? Was it something that had a big impact on you at the time, or it was more recently that you sort of picked it up?
It was almost immediate. I had already liked U2. I liked Boy. War made a huge impact, especially New Year's Day. So I had already liked them. But then when this came out, it made such a huge impact because I thought, that's sort of where I want some of my music and my guitar playing and my keyboards to go. I like the effects. I had been experimenting with feeding one effect into another, such as feeding a delay into a reverb, or then perhaps feeding that into say a chorus or a flanger. And so when I heard that, it just really made such a huge impression on me. It was something that I wanted to pursue, not necessarily sounding like U2, but having those sorts of sounds and those feelings and that soul and that emotion, but through effects and delay and through sparseness, not constantly playing all the time, but letting the notes ring out and hang.
Do you think that, I mean, you say prior to this album, you did like U2. You'd enjoyed Boy. Do you think prior to this album, you were more into what Brian Eno was doing than what U2 was doing? I mean, you referred to this album as having been like a bridge of those two worlds. Which side of the bridge were you closer to before this album?
Oh, I think I've always sort of straddled both fences, but musically, I was doing something that was much closer to Brian Eno. Mm. I had been listening to Another Green World and some of his ambient albums, such as his Airport album and things like that. And so in terms of the music that I was actually creating, I was probably more on the Eno side than the U2 side. And this just made such a huge impact because it felt like just, you know, with Eno, it always felt like I'm doing this sort of experimental niche stuff. And then when U2 sort of took it and ran with it, I realized that this was of some cultural significance because it was bridging the gap between the two worlds. It was interesting pop and rock music fused with this experimentalism. And I remember thinking at the time, this is our Beatles. The previous Whoa. Generation had the Beatles. This is our Beatles.
Sorry, I'm just going to sit quietly for a moment.
So, yeah, so yeah, Ken, Matthew's, I think it's fair to say, a major Beatles fan. So, and just on the Eno thing, though, you mentioned about the two worlds coming together. I know that Eno was incredibly reluctant and initially said no to producing the album and actually came to do the initial sessions with the intent of saying, hey, guys, here's Daniel Lanois. He's the guy you actually want to produce it. See you later. And it took quite a bit of convincing for him to stay, and then they ended up splitting roles with Eno sort of taking on that more conceptual role as far as here's how we should frame the music, and then Lanois doing the actual technical chops around the recording and the instruments used.
That's exactly what I've heard. I heard that initially Eno really wasn't having any of it in either case, and so apparently Bono had called him. I believe he called him from this payphone and talked with Eno impassionately for something like 45 minutes. And Brian Eno had said to him, you do realize that if I were to have anything to do with producing your album, I would completely change how you sound. And Bono said, that's exactly what we want. And so Eno agreed to meet with him, bringing Lanois along just as you described. And apparently Bono's powers of persuasion and I think how earnest and emotional U2 is, I think just won them over, you know, probably just as much as people as musically.
No, I agree. And I think the castle helped too. I mean, what comes across to me in that documentary is just how stunning that castle is, and as pretentious as it can be to record in it. In retrospect, I can see why they chose it.
Oh, it's gorgeous. I always wished I could record in a castle like that.
Absolutely.
We have a dearth of castles around California.
Yeah, same here. Same here.
you can't just commission a McMansion with a 30-foot high ceiling.
I'll get right on that.
So take us back to your first listen, Ken. Do you remember where you were and what you were like? What format was it on? What did you do? What was the situation when you had that first listen of the album?
Sure, it was on CD. I bought the album right away because I had heard that Eno and Lanois were producing them, and so I bought it. I don't remember when, but it was for sure within the first week, and I listened to it with headphones on, lying in bed, and it made a huge impression on me because just right from the start, you could, even within the first 10 or 20 seconds, I found myself thinking, this is different. This is completely different. And this is what I was hoping for. And you could hear that the drums sounded different. It was more mysterious. It was more effects laden, and it basically just reeled me in from the start, and pretty much from the first lesson to this day, it's been my favorite U2 album, and for that matter, one of my favorite albums of all time.
What song do you think made the most impact on you at the time?
The title song.
So one of the conventional songs on it. One of the ones with less of Brian Eno's touch, as it were. I mean, that's one that, according to legend, at any rate, pretty much Eno took a back seat and said, you know, Daniel can do this one.
Yeah,
it was too conventional for him. He couldn't really do much with it.
Right, that one and
same with Pride.
Yeah, that one and Pride, right.
But that was the one that kind of grabbed you. That's the one. It refers to an art gallery exhibit about Hiroshima, if I remember correctly. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah, but it's not actually about Hiroshima.
No. Only the title is from that. I believe it was inspired by that, but. To be quite honest, I'm still not entirely sure what the lyrics are about. There's some people who think it's about Jesus because there's some lines about that that might apply
it's Bono. All the lyrics are about Jesus.
Well, okay. <There is that. laughs> Some people speculate that it perhaps could be about a one-night stand or, a sort of impassionate affair. I have no idea what it's about, but I just know that...
What's it about to you?
I truly don't know what it's about to me. I just... The whole thing comes together with how the lyrics sound, perhaps, how the song sounds... as just something that is just utterly magical, that it's this world that I love to stick my head into. And I come away really inspired and oddly calmer.
And probably the keyboard nerd in me, Ken, and I know you've got a keyboard nerd in you as well. I think it's fair to say, I mean, the Fairlight CMI was getting fairly well ensconced in use in albums, but obviously not within U2's. Back catalogue. I think that stood out for me, the use of that instrument within that song.
Definitely. And the strings as well, which I thought, I don't know this for a fact, but I had always had the impression that was sort of an Eno influence, although I don't believe he actually did the score or anything. But I had always imagined that would be the Eno influence on this album. Or the song, rather.
Eno had been doing experimentation with strings on other projects as well. So, yeah, I think you're right that he wasn't doing orchestrations as such, but he was using strings as, you know, an instrument, as a sort of tool in the toolbox for his projects more broadly and brought them to bear with U2 on this one. In a lot of ways, I actually think of The Unforgettable Fire as more of a Brian Eno album than as a U2 album, where he's kind of using U2 as an instrument for a project of his.
Definitely in a way, or perhaps a project with him and Lanois. I mean, him and Lanois were doing some of the ambient albums, and it was almost like they thought, okay, we have some more musicians that we can treat or take them to uncomfortable positions or experiment with.
Yeah, like just telling Bono, stand there and improvise, and we're just going to record it, and we're just going to take the bits that we want and use the things. You know, clearly, this isn't really Bono's thing. This is something Eno's doing, and he's using Bono as an instrument.
Right, exactly.
And what's interesting too is you can argue too that he totally changed the direction of them for many albums to come. I'm trying to think how many of their albums he produced. He was definitely involved with. I'm just having a quick look here. Yeah, Actung Baby, and I thought he'd been involved in Pop too, but I think I've got no Line on the Horizon, How to Dismantle an Atomic Bomb. So I mean, he's had a massive impact. But I think this was Eno's only involvement. I think Ken, wasn't it?
Right.
Yeah, sorry, Joshua
Tree. Right, but he had a more recent one with that song, Surrender, I believe. What album is that from?
The most recent one?
It's either the most recent...
Songs of Innocence?
Was it? I'm really bad with them.
It's one of the last two.
I believe it's before the most recent.
Yeah, also called the Mandatory album, I like to think of it.
Right.
So aside from the Unforgettable Fire, Ken, and I mean, Pride is obviously was one of their biggest hits of all time. What other songs really stand out for you on that album?
Oh, you know, it's funny to think about this because in a way that I don't with other albums, I frequently think of this as one work, so it's hard to separate apart from that. But
it's actually a really, really good point you've made there, because I mean, I've listened to this album dozens of times, but I did the usual. I'll listen to it three times before the podcast, and I still really struggle to pick out song titles besides the obvious ones like Unforgettable Fire, Pride, and Bad. The rest of them I really struggle, so it sort of adds credence to your point that it's really one work, because if you tell me which one's MLK, I'd be hard pushed to tell you which song it was, aside from being the last one.
Yeah, actually, I was going to mention that as one of my favorites. That song sounds like a hymn to me.
Sleep tonight.
Stark. There's just a keyboard drone and Bono, and that's it. And so that one is such a beautiful song. It's stark. It's just absolutely gorgeous. It's meditative. It has that gauze once again. It sounds like a hymn that something perhaps an ancient song that someone might have sung at church.
Yeah, absolutely. And see, now that you've mentioned it, I can totally hear that song in my head. But if you'd said, what's the name of it, I would have been hard-pushed to remember.
MLK remains a sort of cornerstone of their live shows even now, where most of what's on the Unforgettable Fire is rarely, if ever, performed. But MLK is there in practically every show.
Yeah, that's a good point. They Pride is a huge concert hit. And MLK.
But they hardly ever perform it.
Oh, no, it's still one. No, it's considered one of their most performed songs live.
Is it?
Yeah, MLK and Bad. And those are the staples from this album for concerts anyway.
And I think, I don't know, in the last tour, Bad has fallen off a little bit, and I'd argue it's because the requirements on Bono's voice for that song, I'd say he's probably just aged a little bit too much, or they've dropped it down a few semitones.
Right. Yeah, he's definitely not hitting the high notes like he was before.
No. And I mean, for me, that's the most powerful song on that album is Bad. And that Live Aid performance, which I believe you looked at, Matthew, it's just incredible. I mean, it's 11 minutes. It's still a bit pretentious, but that's with the benefit of hindsight. But he gave
right. A bit pretentious, yeah, a little bit.
You know, if you're getting there.
It's pretentious even by Bono standards. Come on.
Right. They're sort of a pretentious band, but they just do it well. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. After the Queen Live Aid performance, I'd put that one pretty much up there after that.
Exactly. Yeah, so Bad is definitely up there as well. So Unforgettable Fire, MLK, and Bad for me are really standouts. But, you know, I just absolutely love Promenade and 4th of July as well. Surrender. Also, this is something that people don't mention very much because it's sort of an overlooked song, but I think as someone who plays a bit of guitar, Indian Summer Sky, the particularly the intro, but all the way through, there's these shards of guitar chords that the Edge uses. There's a sense of violence with his guitar chording. And I really like that. It's just, it makes it really powerful.
Yeah, and I personally think I'd love to have about 6 episodes just discussing The Edge. He's the guy that if I had a choice of hanging out with one of them for a day, he'd be the one. I don't know about you guys. I'm pretty sure, Matthew, you wouldn't choose Bono. Or could be wrong.
I would not. Look, if you said to me, gun to your head, you have to hang out with a member of U2, the Edge would be the one. I think he's the one that I think has, you know, something interesting to say and isn't completely up himself, but right. You know,
he's philosophical, but he's not completely full of himself. I think
he's able to, you know, parody himself a little bit,
right? Right.
Which I'm really not sure Bono can do that.
I'm not sure either.
I mean, he tried in theory with the Zooropa album and that, as far as, you know, parodying the rock star. But I think it was more parodying the broader concept of a rock star than himself.
He went right the whole way around and became the parody, unfortunately.
Yeah. But as far as spending time with the, I think The Edge, although it depends on the purpose. So if I was wanting to, you know, get all the juicy rock and roll lifestyle stories, Adam Clayton would be the one to talk to.
I don't know. I think. He'd be a bit embarrassed about all the rock and roll lifestyles.
I think he would be,
frankly.
No, I think you're right. And I mean,
I think it'd be a bit insensitive to ask him about the rock and roll lifestyle stories, frankly.
But if you got
right, but
he's
the one who used to he's the one who used to run down hotel lobbies naked, or whatever it was, or hotel hallways naked. And
they've all done that, haven't they?
I don't know. I thought it was more him.
Didn't they record part of the Unforgettable Fire naked?
Yes. They did in Slade Castle, yeah.
Right.
But I mean,
yeah, I don't like
that's a little bit different from partying with supermodels and running down the hallway naked.
A little bit, yes. Yeah.
Well, it was around that supermodel time that I've only seen you two live 3 times, and I'm about to ask you, Ken, about your live experiences. But one of the 3 times I've seen you two live was, I think, the only time, and correct me if I'm wrong, that they've played without Adam Clayton, which was at Sydney.
Oh,
on the the zoo was called the Zoomerang tour, which was part of the Zooropa tour, a Zoo TV tour, more worldwide. And I can't remember what the reason was. I won't go as far as saying it was definitely drugs, but there was some issue and he wasn't able to appear on stage that night. So his bass technician stepped in and played that show.
Oh, interesting. They've been fully intact all three times I've seen them.
Okay. All right. So you've seen them three times over what time frames, Ken?
85, 86. No, I'm sorry. I've seen them four times. Sorry. 85, 87, 2009, and this year.
Okay, so the Joshua Tree. And I did see your pictures of the Joshua Tree too. It looks spectacular.
It really was. So the last two times were in at the Rose Bowl, which is enormous. It's approaching 100,000 people.
Yeah, well, that's a big venue.
and everybody there felt that Bono was singing to them individually, didn't they?
Probably so.
Yeah.
But he does have a way of engaging people, and with a U2 concert, it's frequently an emotional roller coaster. They really are very good at pushing emotional buttons.
And I'd argue, and this comes from someone that is a big U2 fan, I'd argue that they have to do that with their music because aside from Bono, they're a bloody boring band on stage.
I suppose you're right.
I mean, compared to some, I tend to compare everything against Springsteen, but as far as the dynamism on stage, U2 definitely aren't renowned for that, although Bono definitely does his best to keep things theatrical and moving, but they're not exactly, you know, thrashing away on stage.
Yeah, that is true. I mean, you'll get Bono, at least he's sort of moving. He's usually swaying and the other two, well, you know.
The other thing that stood out for me from the Unforgettable Fire documentary is how cheerful and animated Larry Mullen Jr. was as a drummer back then versus every single interview I've seen since where he never smiles or rarely smiles and never says more than four words.
No, more recent things, he almost seems like he has autism.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't know if you saw the Graham Norton show appearance, the one where Bono told everybody he's got glaucoma or whatever it is.
Oh, okay.
Adam, no, sorry, it was Larry. Practically didn't say two words the whole thing. You know, that Norton was really trying to draw him out and get him to interact and get him to say something and be part of it. He was sitting there just absolutely stock silent.
Which was interesting.
Odd.
Yeah, and it's
interesting.
And it comes across to me, at least, as weariness with the whole thing and that he's sick of it, even though that may absolutely not be the case.
But it certainly comes across like that. Like, why wouldn't you speak or be more engaged?
Why would you go on a talk show and not talk?
Exactly.
Well, there is that. We don't have this issue on this podcast.
No, we can just keep talking and talking and talking.
Unlike you guys, I've only actually seen U2 live once. Okay. And that was on their 360 tour a few years ago. Where, you know, the stage is this big round platform with spokes coming out of it. And for the vast majority of the concert, the four members of the band are on entirely different parts of the platform.
Right.
and it was this a really surreal and strange experience of watching a band that they weren't a band. There were four individual musicians in entirely different parts of the stadium. It felt completely isolated to me. It was a very, very strange experience. Just talking about what they're like as a live band. It's like, I don't feel like I've seen them as a live band. I've seen four guys wandering around on a big circle.
And I think that links in with their dynamism on stage too. I think they are, you know, brothers in arms from all those years. But I think like a lot of those bands after so long, in this case 40 plus years, that I think distance is what keeps them together.
Yeah, perhaps so.
It's like the Stones. I have no doubt when the Stones come on stage, the first time they've actually seen each other face-to-face that day is just backstage in the 2 minutes before. They're not hanging out.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Yeah. Although I don't know if this is true or not. I have the impression that U2 is a little bit closer than the Stones are.
I think you're right. Yeah.
Definitely. They've been through a lot together.
And that Unforgettable Fire documentary, again, I mean, they lived together for the camaraderie at Slane Castle to sort of, you know, make sure they're all on the same page. I doubt they would do that now, but I think they'd be able to pull it off better than the Stones or a lot of the other older bands.
Well, they've all got families now.
That's right.
Right, that's what's changed.
And so, Ken, what is there anything about, or there probably is, about the album that still gets you going now? If you put it on tomorrow and have a listen, you know, does it still inspire you to create yourself or has other impacts on you?
It does. It does. I still am inspired by the overall sound and the emotional resonance of the songs. I still tend to play the whole album all the way through as if it were one piece of work. So I still get the same feeling that I did when I first heard it.
And that's an unusual thing.
It is. It's a remarkably, at least for me, it's a remarkably timeless sort of album.
Yeah.
And that's interesting. That's interesting. Cause I don't think that it feels like a very 80s album to me, but so that's interesting.
Yeah. It sounds
kind of out of time.
It does sound, it has a lot of the hallmarks of an 80s album, but I also feel like it steps outside that somehow and feels very timeless as well.
Mm. Can I just ask, as a sort of a companion thing, I mean, Wide Awake in America, the EP that followed it, where, right. You know, it's supplemented by, for instance, a longer version of... Bad, I think it is.
Yeah,
probably
it was
bad. And a sort of
a live version of Bad, because of course the studio version on Unforgettable Fire was criticized as sort of not really working as a studio song, but as a live song, of course
it's astounding, you know, live.
It comes to life, and on that EP, it was released, I think, like 6 months or 7 months after the Unforgettable Fire.
Right.
There's the live version of Bad. Do you sort of see that as kind of a piece with the Unforgettable Fire, or do you still see them as separate works?
No, I always associated them together. It felt like the same sort of thing, and it wouldn't surprise me if some of the other songs from Wide Awake in America were done at the same time or conceived at the same time as Unforgettable Fire. Actually, Three Sunrises is also one of my favorite songs.
Really?
Yes.
Because that was a B-side, wasn't it?
That's a good question. I don't know.
Whipping out the Wikipedia here.
Thank God for Wikipedia.
Right. Yeah, we're on it because that's what I'm doing too.
Yeah. I mean, and just on, while you're looking up Wikipedia on the issue of that follow-up release and also them being a close unit, one of the funniest quotes from that documentary on the Unforgettable Fire is Bono trying to be deep and meaningful and basically saying, "We're so close that we really are a four-legged table." And I thought, well, yeah, that's
right.
I'd rather you were a four-legged table. I would have thought that was the base requirement to be successful rather than a three-legged table. And a five-legged
doesn't... A three-legged table can work very well.
With books or something.
It could.
You know, and a five-legged table doesn't mean you're necessarily better. So I just thought it was...
You can't get as many chairs in.
I did really appreciate that sentiment in a way. I mean, philosophically, they're basically saying that they all go at it together.
Yes.
And it's more equal. And it's unlike, say, what you would expect from, like, say, a Bruce Springsteen or Bob Dylan band, where you would expect that they're the dominant songwriter and their word is last. So
I agree. I think the only two bands you can argue are that communal that I'm aware of would be U2, and in the Australian context, and you may not have heard of them, Ken, is Hunters and Collectors had that real, not communist, but that real communal feel to everything.
Right, right. I've heard of them, but I'm not super familiar with them. So the Three Sunrises is another favorite. I also really like Love Comes Tumbling, which I just think is gorgeous. That definitely sounds a little bit more stereotypically 80s, I suppose, but in some respects. But the Three Sunrises, I love everything about that, including, once again, the guitar playing, which is just stunning to me.
And so did we get to the bottom of whether it was a B-side or not?
You know, I still have not found it.
Oh, Wikipedia, let us down.
Wikipedia is failing me. It has a separate entry for just about every song that U2 has ever done, but not for the Three Sunrises.
Well, obviously it appeared on this EP, Wikipedia states, it also can be found on the B-sides disc of the limited edition of the best of 1980 compilation.
But what was it the B-side of?
Yeah. Whole album.
Yeah.
I mean, U2.com, I haven't been on, I used to be a subscriber on U2.com and they had a really active forum on there. I'm not sure whether it's still there, but I guarantee you could ask that question, get an answer within 22 seconds.
Probably.
So I think, you know, any other thoughts on Unforgettable Fire?
No, it's as you say, though, it was a real turning point for the band and highly influential. And I think even though, one of the criticisms launched against the album was that some of the songs were unfinished or they were sketches. To me, the highs of the Unforgettable Fire are higher than a lot of the highs from the Joshua Tree. And there's just something about the emotional potency about the Unforgettable Fire that really speaks to me, even though I like Joshua Tree almost as much as the Unforgettable Fire. But there's just something that really speaks to me about the Unforgettable Fire.
So maybe we should have said this.
Guys, it's one of the B-sides on the 12-inch version of the single of the Unforgettable Fire.
There you go.
There you go.
And Ken, I feel like we should have set this podcast up as a debate of Unforgettable Fire versus Joshua Tree. I totally agree on their sketches. And then I'd argue Joshua Tree are the fully fledged paintings, which has its advantages.
I would agree.
Yeah. Amazing.
I would agree. And I can completely understand why Joshua Tree in many ways overshadows the Unforgettable Fire, because it is more completely conceived. And I believe it's also more consistent.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There are more strong tracks on it.
I really believe that. And I can completely understand why many people would favor the Joshua Tree over this. It's just that for some reason, something about this just really speaks to me. Even the more unfinished sketches, they just really speak to me.
Yeah. Can I throw in a theory? The two of them are, you know, the U2 and Eno period. Unforgettable Fire, I would say, has more of a balance in favor of Eno. Joshua Tree has more of a balance in favor of U2.
Yeah.
With an Eno influence. So,
and my suspicion
as somebody who stands more on the Eno side of the bridge, it speaks to you more.
Right.
That's a theory.
Right, and yeah, you very well could be onto something. I also think that perhaps Lanois had more of an influence on the Joshua Tree.
Yeah, I also think the working pace, I haven't actually looked at how the exact information, how they recorded Joshua Tree, but I mean, with Unforgettable Fire, they had so much unfinished stuff in those last 2 weeks that they were putting in 20-hour days to get it finished, and I can't imagine that was the process for the Joshua Tree.
Yeah.
I suspect Joshua Tree, they were setting their own deadlines.
That's right.
Frankly.
Yeah.
Yeah. I should mention, by the way, that I've actually met Daniel Lanois about 3 times.
Oh, really?
Yeah. Yeah. So perhaps he still does, but he lived in Los Angeles for a while. He lived in an area called Echo Park, which is a subsection of Los Angeles. And I'd run into him a number of times, either at gigs or he would have. He would have smaller shows, and I would just sort of run into him and speak to him real briefly. So it's not like I'm friends with him and call him up and go bowling with him, but I have met him several times, and he's very charismatic. And all three times that I've met him, he just seems to love women. I mean, he will just flirt with just about every woman who comes his way. He just loves them. So, yeah, definitely an interesting guy, and one of the best producers working, for sure.
And Ken, I can't remember the context of the story, but I know one of the photos I most associate with you is you standing next to Jimmy Page.
Oh, yeah.
So how did that come about?
Yeah, so I had just started getting into photography, and on Facebook, one of my friends, Crystal, who is a journalist, she was working for the Huffington Post at the time, and she announced on Facebook that she was very excited because she was going to interview Jimmy Page for a movie documentary, It Might Get Loud, which, if you remember, was also done with Jack White and The Edge.
Oh, yep.
Right? And so I immediately followed up a comment saying something like, hey, if you need a photographer, please let me know. Just putting it out there, right? And so she messaged me and said, actually, I do need a photographer. So you're on. And so I went to, it was held in a large hotel on Wilshire. So we had I was photographing the press conference in which the three, it was Jimmy Page, the producer, I cannot remember the producer right off the top of my head, and Jack White were fielding questions from the press. And so I was taking photos and everything like that. And then Crystal came up to me and said, okay, so, you know, make sure your camera's ready because we're going to interview them. And I said, what? And she said, we're interviewing them one-on-one. And I had not known this, but she managed to get this going. So we were there for just maybe about 5 minutes. I walked in and... Jimmy Page, who is extremely engaging and cordial, very friendly, looked at me and he said, did you get enough photos? And I said, yes, I did. And he said, okay, because I saw you taking photos and then I sort of lost track of you. And what had happened was that I was with the press corps and I just sort of snuck off to the side of the room and sat down on the floor and then continued taking photos, and he didn't see me there. But somehow he had noted that out of this crowd of, what, you know, like 60 people, I had snuck off. Mm. And so I thought that was really quite remarkable. And no offense to Jack White, you know, I really like Jack White and I respect him and all, but I had really hoped that The Edge would be there.
Yeah.
And because I really wanted to, I wanted to meet The Edge pretty much, you know, almost as much as Jimmy Page. And so Jimmy Page, by the way, is one of my favorite guitar players. That they're pretty much one and two, I think. Yeah. And so I was disappointed that he wasn't there. But, you know, nonetheless, I was just thrilled to meet Jimmy Page, who was really articulate, engaging, friendly, seemed real sharp, and looked real healthy when I saw him.
That's all you can ask for.
Right, exactly. Yeah.
And there's even a U2 reference in there. So I was about to say, I'm going to argue it was Brian Eno that was the producer on that album, even though it wasn't, just to keep the U2 references going. I kind of imagine Brian Eno producing Jack White and Jimmy Page. That'd be interesting.
That would be pretty trippy.
Well, Ken, I think we've covered it nicely. Again, thank you so much. And we will have a link in the show notes to Ken's website. Ken's probably undersold himself a little bit on his photography. I know you've been nominated. And am I wrong, Ken, have received some rewards for your photography Awards, sorry?
I've been really lucky. I mean, when you consider that I only started doing night photography about 5 years ago, I feel like I've received a fair amount of accolades. So I don't know. The thing that leaps to mind, two things that leap to mind is I've been featured several times as the photographer, the travel photographer or travel photo of the year for the Los Angeles Times, and have been featured in there for about the last 4 or 5 years. And I've had a print. I've had one photo of the ancient bristlecone pine forest in National Geographic books, which is just huge and enormous, and features in the Smithsonian, a number of other newspapers, magazines, and things like that. But those first two really stick out for me. The LA Times, partially because when I was a kid, I used to look through the travel section, and I would be just gobsmacked by these gorgeous photos of these really exotic far-off lands. And then to be actually not only featured in that same section, but actually win some prizes just really means just as much to me as the National Geographic appearance.
Yeah. Well done. Congratulations.
And, I believe the reports are still unconfirmed that you're the photographer on U2's next release, the Joshua Tree plaque.
That's right. Especially if they want a night photo with light painting, you know, some sort of a long exposure night photography. Yeah,
you're the man.
I think. Yeah, I'm the person they should call.
Ken, thank you.
Sure, it's my pleasure. This was a lot of fun, and perhaps we could do it again sometime.
Absolutely.
One man come in the name of love. One man come and go. One man come here to justify. One man to overthrow.
So there we have it. I think we all came to some sort of consensus.
I think I got to tell you, the revelation for me out of that was that the Joshua Tree, the cover of the Joshua Tree album, is not actually in Joshua Tree Memorial, or Joshua Tree Monument National Park there. That it's in the Mojave Desert, or that it was in the Mojave Desert, and now there's a plaque there. You know, that made me think of... You know old El Paso taco kits?
Yes.
The Mexican food brand.
Absolutely.
And they got the Saguaro cactuses on the logo for Old El Paso. There are no Saguaro cactuses anywhere near El Paso.
Okay.
So the fact that the Joshua Tree that's on the front of the Joshua Tree isn't in Joshua Tree.
And I got to say, I'm glad I found that
all
out.
All of a sudden, that album has become like taco mix for me.
Yeah. I'm glad I found it out from the viewpoint. It is one of those locations I would love to see before I die. And I think I would have been devastated had I gone all the way to the Joshua Tree National Park and then found out that the one from the album's not even there.
You're in the wrong place, sorry. Yes. Yeah, no, that was that. That's in the Mojave Desert. But don't go, because it's not there anyway.
Yeah, that's right. Well, you can see the plaque.
Your photographs.
Yeah, look at the plaque.
Look at the plaque. There's a plaque for a tree. That amazes me. I like it somehow. I like the fact that they memorialize a tree.
I just love how there's those key rock icons as far as Jim Morrison's grave in Paris, and now we've got the plaque where the Joshua Tree was in the Mojave Desert. It's
equally important places, I think. Yes. Equally important.
See, you've come over to the dark side, Matthew. So, yeah, look, a huge thanks.
Only no, that was a fun talk. That was a fun talk.
Yeah, huge thanks to Ken. And it is one of the strangest things about the internet that Ken and I have hung out online for so many years. And it's absolutely lovely to talk to him in person, so to speak. I think that's it for this episode. We will be back, as always, with in about a month's time with episode 8. I can't allude to an album this stage. We've got a couple of balls in the air, although one I will allude to that is coming up, but maybe not next month, and I haven't actually told you this yet, Matthew, is I think Van Morrison's going to be a topic of discussion in the next few months.
For a second, I thought you were going to tell me Van Morrison was going to be our guest.
No, give me time.
that would do me. That'd be.
I don't know. I think I'd find that too stressful. I think he's a bit of a prickly character from everything I've heard.
Really?
I could be wrong.
I know very little about him except the music.
Yeah, so. I've heard he's not the most fun to deal with, but that's, you know, who knows.
Look, I think that's the kind of thing that happens to you, and when you're, you know, that famous for that long, you know, you end up finding it difficult to trust people.
That's right. Maybe that's Larry Mullen Jr.'s issue.
Maybe.
We love you, Larry. Or I love you, at least. All right. I
don't know him, so I don't want to declare my undying love for him. Just at this point, I think we should meet first. Maybe go for coffee.
And as, again, one last keyboard nerd reference. I'd like to give a shout out to Terry Lawless, U2's longtime keyboard player that sits below the stage. As always, if you'd like to offer an opinion, suggestion, or even offer yourself up as a guest, we're still up for guests, although we do have a few on the boil, but we'd love to hear from you if you'd like to come on and talk about an album. Please do feel free to...
Or entomology, if you wanted to talk about entomology.
See, that's good. That's the fifth episode in a row you've got that in. That's good. please feel free to email us at contact...
It's my thing now.
It is your thing. email us at contact@themusicweek.net or visit our vastly growing Facebook page, Music Dissectors. To keep things spread well among the decades, if you have an album from the 80s, 90s or 2000s, we'd especially love to hear from you as far as being a guest. Previous episodes of the show are definitely on iTunes. We're also on Stitcher and TuneIn. And all episodes are on our website at themusicweek.net. While I think of it too, a big shout out to a couple of great people, if I didn't do so last episode, that have given reviews on iTunes. Those reviews on iTunes actually make a huge difference as far as the podcast getting out there. If you do have an iTunes account and are listening, would love if you could provide a review. So, but particular thanks to Chris and Lynette for their reviews, including one on the US iTunes store.
Ooh.
So we're international, Matthew.
Wow.
And I don't think it was a previous guest.
I'm going to have to start getting prickly with people.
That's right.
Now that we're famous. My goodness.
So, yes, thanks very much for listening, and thanks as always.
No photos.
Thank you as always, Matthew, giving up a Saturday morning. And, yeah, we'll be back in a few weeks to a month as always. And in the meantime, find a new album to love.